about how you got into comedy, what your background is. And
sure. You know, I'm hanging out with some friends of mine, and you know, I'm always a silly one in the group, cracking jokes and everything else. And so one of my best friends, who was part of the band Marky Mark and the Funky Bunch, DJT, we were going to his rehearsal, and we walked by this office door in the rehearsal facility that said comedy at the Cantab, and he was like, you're doing it.
And so just clear this up, were you in high school still when this happened, or was it
it was after high school.
Okay, okay.
So he was like, you know, you're doing it. And I went in that room, and that's where it started. I had no material, and I auditioned for this guy. I was like, I'm thinking about being a comedian. And I did 5 minutes, and he thought I was funny. And the next thing you know, I was doing stand-up at the Cantab Lounge in Cambridge, in Central Square, I think it is.
Okay, great. And so when you were a kid, were you watching comedians or listening to comedians?
All the time.
And what?
I had no idea. It just appealed to me. Mm-hmm. I didn't have these dreams and aspirations. I can do that. It just appealed to me. And sort of on a level like, wow, he's speaking, and everyone's listening, and they're laughing, and, you know, wow, this is fantastic.
So who were the comedians as a child or a young adult that you were drawn to most?
Believe it or not. Well, I would listen to anything. Mm-hmm. I would listen to anything if it was comedy. And so the early stuff that I could get my hands on, I would hang out with my cousin, and we'd listen to Richard Pryor. So I'm listening to Flip Wilson records, Bill Cosby. So as I got older and I could, you know, sort of obtain the records myself, I would go out and buy tapes or whatever. Some good, some bad, but it all appealed to me.
Now in the present, which comedians are you kind of, do you look at and say, wow, they have got it really going on, I really love their style? And
yeah, I guess I look at different comedians in different aspects. I appreciate different things about different comedians. You know, some might appreciate their business savvy, and some might just appreciate the material, their drive. Some of the comedians I've worked with closely that sort of at the time when we were working took me under their wing and really gave me insight into the business, and I kind of saw it as, wow, this is something. Monique was one of the first ones, and she actually took me on tour with her, and that really was my awakening, because at the time I still felt like I was, I'm just Chris Tabb from Boston, but she took me out, she was doing all theaters, so it was really something different for me, and she would talk to me after every single show, and just give me pointers, and tell me about the business, and it was so valuable, and I just used to think, you know, for someone at her level to take this time out to talk to me, to even bring me out here, was just
to mentor you, really.
To mentor me was tremendous, because I kind of felt like, you know, when I was done with my part, it's done. She doesn't have to say another word to me until she calls me for the next date. But she would sit me down and say, you know, I thought it was great when you did this, and I like having you out here, and, you know, you want to try this, and this is the kind of comic I see you as being. And, you know, that was when I was sort of finding my voice and finding out who I was on stage. Tommy Davidson was another one who I remember the night he asked me to dinner, I was like, you're going to pay, right?
Yeah.
and we went out and ate, and you know, he really appealed to me, because I've always appreciated his style and his energy, and you know, that's one thing you're going to see at a Chris Tabb show, is energy, and I think a lot of that comes from him and how he gives it 110%. And you know, he helped me embrace my inner Chris Tabb, my silly nerd kind of guy.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And people usually ask, you know, what can we expect from your show, or you know, what style of comedy do you have? I really think my inner voice is still coming out, but you know, it's a little bit silly, it's a little bit off kilter, and you know, I like the comedian that I am, and I'm waiting to see what else is going to happen.
Stay tuned, there's so much more in store. Just leave the doubt right where it's at. because we will be right back.
We put your hands together for Mr. Chris Tabb.
Hey, come here.
Where the hell am I? Wow.
Writing and working on new material and adjusting things for your shows?
I think I write a lot on stage. I write a lot on stage. You know, and
so
I,
improv.
Improv, but I think that it's an aspect of it where I can't really write it down because it'll lose something if it hits the paper to me. Or if I have it in my head, I'd rather just get on stage and say it and see where it goes. Mm-hmm.
And why are you looking forward to performing in Springfield in Western Mass as opposed to what you're used to out in the eastern state?
Well, it's kind of like you sort of get outside your comfort zone. You know, New England is very comfortable for me. Boston is super comfortable for me. You know, I don't get the chance to perform in Springfield that often. You know, I came out to do the Mom Squad. So, you know, to be able to finally let it go, Chris Tabb in long form, I'm headlining, I'm closing the show, it's quite an honor. I mean, so many great names have graced the stage here at City Stage, so, you know, to follow in those footsteps, you know, I think this might be the Apollo of the Mass Pike. This is the Apollo Theater.
It was great to actually have you on site here for our comedy auditions this year.
Sure.
It was judged by Vax and O'Brien from Rock 102 and Tina D'Agostino, our interim president. But to have you here kind of being the onlooker this year,
sure,
instead of on stage sweating it out with everybody else, it was kind of,
right.
I mean, how did you...
I just felt like I was where those guys were. You know, and I know what it can lead to. So, you know, I'm still a student of comedy. I still like learning and listening and growing and, you know, seeing the newer guys and, you know, it's like I still feel like a new guy, you know. So it was great to see the process continue and to see City Stage embrace that, because it's very important to a comedian to be respected in some regard. I mean, it's a lonely man's sport, but to have an arena like this or an audience like this respected and sort of embrace the comedians and say, come on, show us what you got and we'll give you a shot. And, you know, I'm sort of living proof that it could happen.
And we're really looking forward to having you here. And I know, in addition to your work as a very successful comedian in Massachusetts and New England, you're also heavily involved with the American Stroke Association.
Yes.
And can you tell me a little bit about your involvement with that organization?
Yes, near and dear to my heart. Both my parents suffered strokes in the same year, months apart. And, you know, so I'm a firsthand witness to how it can change not only, obviously, the stroke victim's life, but the life of the caregiver. So you just sort of have to go into a different mode. And now, you know, caring for my parents, as they would have cared for me when I was younger, definitely put my mindset in a different area. You know, so when that happened, I just, you know, started learning and so forth. But at the same time, I was being booked to do a stroke comedy show called Strokes No Joke. I just wanted to perform at this thing, and somehow through a series of events, I ended up hosting. So I ended up being even further connected with the Stroke Association. I began to meet, you know, the marketing director and different people involved with it. The event went off incredibly. It was great. Six comedians, and we had a great, great time. They raised a whole lot of money. The Stroke Association reached out to me after that and said, we want to continue to work with you. And I still hadn't told them about, you know, my parents or anything. So when I finally got to sit down and meet with them, I told them, you know, it was touching me in a different way, you know, that I'm able to help and I'm willing to do what it is they needed me to do. And I didn't understand what the role meant. And it was just create awareness. go out into the areas that maybe they can't get to. So in essence, they needed and wanted a Chris Tabb.
Yeah.
And I guess it worked out for them, it worked out for me, so I've been able to speak on behalf of the Stroke Association to different groups, hosting their caregivers forum right here in Springfield at the Mass Mutual Center. I've done that 2 years in a row. And also, so after that amazing first year, I had two fundraisers for them, you know, comedy fundraisers. I was recognized at the Apollo Theater as one of their power ambassadors. So it was, I think, 12 or 13 people from around the country that had created the stroke awareness. And, you know, that moment, I'll never forget it. I'll never, ever forget that. And things really crystallized for me. No pun intended, I got a crystal.
And just not to mention, not very many people get to walk across the Apollo Theater stage and win an award.
Goodness, it was unreal. Yes. Just
pretty
seeing
amazing.
Your name announced and everything else. And the concert was great. It was just gospel concert. And it just blew me away. So, you know, it really brought it together for me at that moment. So I'm continuing to work with those folks and create awareness and have events. So anything I can do to help, you know. And I talk to my parents about what I'm doing. And, you know, my mom and dad now need round-the-clock care. So, you know, I sort of go back and forth between both homes and help out when I can. And, you know, it's great. My mom asked me about my shows and everything. So I'll be able to tell her now on that city stage.
Yeah, definitely. And we'll send her home with one of our posters when the show's all said and done.
There it is. I get my first poster. I'll sign it.
Yeah,
it'll be great.
So, well, I don't know if you want to talk a little bit about your show and your style a little bit.
Sure. Like I said, if you come to a Chris Tabb comedy show, you're always going to get 115%. I'm going to give you what you came to see.
Sheer entertainment.
Sheer entertainment.
Wild, crazy Chris Tabb, as we know him here at City Stage.
Yeah, wild, crazy, sure. I'll take that title.
I
sure.
do. I like that title for you. I think it fits. Crazy in a good way, not like psychopath crazy.
Not like psychopath crazy. No, I promise not to come into the audience.
How about wild and zany.
Oh my God. Zany's good.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll take
cool. All right, great. Well, thanks for sitting with me and chatting today.
Thank you, Bevan.
And we're looking forward to having you on stage on January 28th.
January 28th, let's do it.
Yeah, we're doing it. Here we go.